Hi everybody, Moonsong Magic over here. Today we're going to be making these resin mermaid pendants. If you want to know how I do it, please watch to the very end. And if you like the content, don't forget to like and subscribe. So let's first talk about what we're going to be needing. First things first, we need some resin and some hardener, an accurate scale so that you can measure out your portions, side cutters, mixing cups, some colorants for your resin, some cool foliage if you want to add it to your pendants, some other things to decorate your pendants with, the charms that you'd like to inlay into your resin, if you want to add links, some wire, if you're making keychains, keychain rings, and of course the molds that you're going to be working with. Take your kitchen scale and place your measuring cup on top of the scale and make sure you only turn it on after you've got your container on the scale, because then it'll be set at zero. I'm going to measure out a rather generous amount of resin into this container because I intend to work on multiple projects at the same time. So I'm going to pour out approximately 30 grams, or as close to 30 grams as I'm gonna make it. And with the second part of resin, I have to measure the exact equal amount. So it's a 1:1 ratio. So equal amounts of part A and part B. A little recommendation that if you get any spillage while you're pouring your resin is that you clean it up right away, because you do not want any of that hardening on any of your surfaces. Now, take your stirring stick, and now this is the tricky part. You have to very, very patiently and gently mix part A and part B together. Now, the reason why you have to be slow and patient with this is because you don't want to encourage bubbles into your resin, okay? The more effort you put into your stirring process, the better the outcome will be. Okay, so I stirred for about 3 to 5 minutes, making sure it was mixed. Now I'm going to allow the resin to become a bit tacky, so I'm going to go on and cut off the loops on my charms so that they just look a little bit neater once they are embedded into my pendants. So I'm not in a particular rush when I do this because I'm allowing the resin some time to just get a little bit more tacky so that when I put it into the molds, the charms won't just immediately sink to the bottom, so that there'll be a little bit of resistance to the resin. So in these examples, I have used some starfish and I've used little mermaid charms to go inside of my pendants. Okay, so now that I've cut that all out, I'm going to get the molds that I'm going to be working with. There's a starfish I'm going to be experimenting with on the side as well. This is optional, but I do recommend if you can afford that you can get some ease release. This is just going to encourage the resin to release from the molds a little bit better. Alright, so very carefully just encourage some of the resin into the molds. You'll notice that my first layer of resin is clear. Having the first layer clear will allow us to see the decoration and the pendants inside a little better. Okay, so clean up, very important, and then leave for a little while to allow this to become even more tackier. Right, once it's tacky, we're going to then slide in the charms into the mold containers, okay? Do you notice that I'm not just dropping them in, I'm sliding them in, because you don't want any bubbles to form underneath the charm, okay? Because that is very, very difficult to get rid of after the fact. So just go ahead and, slide in your charms. Again, patience is key here. Here's the fun part. Once you've got your basic charms in place, you will notice that you have the freedom to also move them around. So don't get too worried if you've misplaced them initially. You can still shift them around and make sure that they're positioned exactly the way you want. Now we're going to add the decoration. Now you see they are face up on the table. When I'm going to place them into the charms, I have to put them in face down, okay? Because the bottom of these molds is where the front of the pendant is going to be. So don't forget, put them face down. I have two kinds of decoration pieces. I've got little rhinestones and I've got half pearls. Now bear in mind that if you use rhinestones, the faucets, in other words, the dimension of the rhinestone tends to get a bit lost when it's inside of a resin piece. So I just use it for its reflective quality, and it usually has nice vibrant color and it creates three dimensionality as well. So here we are also putting in the half moon pearls. These are a little bit more stubborn to stay face down, so this is a little bit tricky, but as I keep saying, patience is key. Once I'm happy with all the decorated pieces, we're going to allow this to dry even further. While that is busy drying, take your leftover clear resin and just partition it into the number of containers that is equal to the number of colors you'd like to introduce. Okay, so I've got two containers and I want two colors. In this particular experiment, I'm using a much darker blue than I used for my previous colors. And I'm using a lilac, right? Because I want to see how these two are going to respond to each other. We're going to mix them together, all right? So again, same principle as before. Mix slowly and gently and try your best not to encourage any bubbles into the resin liquid. Once again, it'll be great to allow this resin to become a little bit tacky again so that it still holds its shape, because I'm going to be drip pouring it into my clear resin to create little clouds of color. Okay, so it mustn't be too runny, but of course not so hard that it's not going to drip. Looking good. Don't forget to clean up after yourself. That would be a disaster otherwise. Okay, so starting with the starfish, which is one of my experiments, you're going to notice how I'm holding my stick a little distance away from the actual mold and I'm allowing it to drip into the mold. This dripping will break the surface tension of the clear resin and hopefully make a little cloud of color as it lands on the clear layer. There's no right or wrong way. You're just going to feel where you want the color to appear. Oh, don't forget to clean up. Right, and I'm going to do the same thing with the blue. I'm going to drip it directly over the previous layers, creating blue clouds of color. It's a messy job, this. You're constantly having to clean up after yourself. If you intend to create pendants that need a link on them, what I tend to do is I will take some wire. You see, I've put a little bit of a nook in it so that I can direct the wire to dip into the actual mold, but then also to come out at a certain point. Here's the good part. Ah, so satisfying. This is a few hours later, by the way. It takes quite a while. Don't rush this either. Allow your mold pieces to cure quite well before you start handling it. There you go. Can you see the clouds of color? Here are some lighter and darker blues, as well as some other keychain pieces that I've used with the same dripping technique to create those clouds of color. I hope you enjoyed today's tutorial. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you guys next time.